This episode of Fireside Chat is brought to you by TickTix. Buying tickets shouldn't be anonymous. We are built for fans, by fans. Available on Android and iOS. Are you ready? Sea of Red, it's time for another Fireside Chat, the official podcast of Flames fans. It's go time.
We're three games into the season, and right now, somehow, the Flames are sitting at the bottom of the Western Conference while the Oilers are at the top. Not a situation we're used to, but let's break it all down. As usual, I'm Dan Stevenson alongside Matt DeBorg. Matt, what are your thoughts on the first week in general?
Well, you can tell this team has not had a lot of opportunity to play with each other, and especially the first line. They just met each other the day before the opening game of the season, so there's not really a lot that you can do, and to expect them to come firing out of the gate is a little bit optimistic.
I mean, Versteeg's new to the team, Johnny Hockey wasn't around for the preseason, so really this first line got assembled, even though, you know, Johnny Hockey and Sean Monahan played together last year, these guys really just got thrown in together the day before the season started.
Yeah, and anytime you have that kind of a situation, it usually takes 4 or 5 games to adjust to new line mates, just to know instinctually where they're going to be on the ice. And when you only have one practice thus far in the 3 games, you're not going to have as much success as you would if you'd played the entire preseason together.
Well, let's break these games down one at a time in the first week. So we open the season on the 12th in Edmonton at the new Edmonton Arena. As we talked about last week, in when Calgary opened the Saddle Dome, the Oilers were here, and now they're opening a new arena, and we were there. And I was excited about this game. I was watching on TV. I was watching the intro. I don't know about you, but as they were announcing the Oilers, I'm like, I don't know this guy. I don't know this guy. I don't know this guy. There's so many guys in the Oilers team I have never heard of before.
Well, there's a reason why that they haven't made the playoffs since 2006, and they just have not had any success on finding players to actually play through the draft. And you've seen they got rid of 2 of their first 3 number 1 overall selections this past offseason, dealing Nail Yakupov and Taylor Hall. So, of course, there's going to be some growing pains in terms of not having any familiarity with any of their players.
And coming into this game, I was excited about the team. Like you said, there was some things that maybe we were worried about, but the lines were totally different than what we expected, both on the forward and on the blue line. And I think you could really tell that overall guys weren't comfortable with each other as we ended up losing 7-4 to the Oilers.
Yeah, and like TJ Brody, it makes sense that you would want to try him as a left defenseman because he shoots left, and that's where he should normally line up, but his entire career he's been on the right side, and he just looked completely out of place when he wasn't with Giordano, and he struggled. And when you have 3 slower defensemen in Weidman, Englund, and Grossman, and you have speedy forwards on the other side, that's not a recipe for success.
No, it's usually not. And I mean, when you have a pairing like Giordano and Brody, and I understand the new coach trying to figure these things out, but to me, when you've got a team pairing like that, you don't break them up. You know, they feed off each other. They're good because of each other. And it's the first game, and I understand he wants to play with things, and we saw that he very quickly put them back together later in the week. But yeah, to me, it was dumb to even try to break those guys up.
Well, experimentation's never a bad thing, but that's usually what the preseason's for. And they did try Brody on the left side during a couple of the preseason games, and he had a bunch of terrible games in the preseason and did not look himself because he's just not comfortable there. So that should have been a clue that that would not be successful, but it took having a disastrous first game to see reason, and since then he's looked a lot better.
The Flames got goals in that game from a couple newcomers, Troy Brower and Alex Chiasson. Michael Frolik got a goal, and I was really shocked when Dennis Weidman got a goal on that one. at first. And he got a lot of ice time, too. He played over 25 minutes of ice time. But, you know, probably not an indication of what Weidman's going to look like this year, that he'll be our highest scoring defenseman.
Yeah, and that goal actually did tick off an Oilers stick. So that, you know, it wasn't like he cleanly beat the goaltender. It was a deflection. And I thought that Weidman had a poor game in that one and got called on the penalty shot, which pretty much ended the game to give McDavid the 5-3 goal. And all three of the slower defensemen struggled, with Englund being the least bad of the three.
Well, and that's interesting, too, that in the season opener, Jyrki Jokipäkä, I'd say arguably our sort of default number four guy, was benched. He was scratched for the game, and Nick Grossman put in there. And to me, that was the wrong decision, and Grossman looked terrible in that game.
Grossman struggled in the first 5-10 minutes when the first goal, which really that was, too, was a deflection shot, so that... It's one of those situations where it hits you or goes in, and unfortunately it didn't hit Elliott before going in the net. And the other one, he was breaking in on a 2-on-1, and, you know, you can't dump the puck into the corner when you're on a 2-on-1. That was more the responsibility of one of the forwards, which in this case it was Matthew Tkachuk, who should have slid back to the defense to cover the situation. It was more unfortunate in his case. He played better as the game went along, but he should not have been in the lineup in the first place, I agree.
He did lead the Flames in hits in that game with 5 hits, but, I mean, to me, you don't put Grossman in and bench Jokipäkä, especially in a game where there's some, you know, there's an expectation of winning, which I guess is every game, but yeah, it was weird to see Grossman in the lineup in the first game. I've also heard a lot of criticism coming out of this game of Brian Elliott, and I'm already hearing people say, oh, Elliott's, you know, as bad as Hiller, and you know what, the guy, he didn't have a terrible game. Yeah, there's probably about 3 goals they'd want back, but it wasn't just him. I mean, the whole team played terribly, and I don't think that we can judge Elliott based on this one performance.
Well, also, you gotta remember that he and his wife literally just had a child since the start of training camp. So you gotta figure that
not sleeping,
perhaps stirring in the night, you're gonna be woken up from the baby crying. So, you know, fatigue there does become a factor, and give the guy a break. You know, over the last 5 years, he's been the top goalie, one of the top goalies in the NHL in terms of all the statistics. Yeah, he had a bad couple of games, but, you know, when you're giving up that many breakaways and a penalty shot to McDavid and all of that, you know, you're not going to win when you're just playing that sloppily.
And I think if you look at any goalie, I mean, if you look at Kiprusoff, you look at Waugh, if you look at Brodeur, Hasek, any, you know, top-tier goalie, and I'm not trying to compare Elliott to those guys, don't get me wrong, but just as a baseline, even those guys had 2-3-game periods where they didn't look good.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
So it's not the end of the world that our goalie hasn't looked good for the first week of the season. Now, if this was December and he'd been playing like this for a few months, I'd be worried. But after 2 starts, I'm really not that worried about Elliott.
Yeah, if this was December and we were still having this conversation, then Chad Johnson's the starter, and then the conversation is, do we bring Gillies up to back up Johnson and just kind of let Elliott ride the pine entirely? But, you know, that it's 2 games, you know, it's not a big deal.
Overall, I look at this first game in Edmonton. I mean, we outshot the Oilers 41-28. We won 60% of the faceoffs to their 40. On paper, the Flames were playing a better game, but I look at this as an experiment. The lines were weird. Guys weren't used to playing with each other. I just kind of look at this as, you know what, we tried some new things. It didn't work out for us, and let's move on.
Yep, and sometimes weird stuff happens. That's life. It's a loss, big deal. It only counts for 1 in the season. And yes, move on to the next game.
And the next game was the same 2 teams, Calgary and Edmonton, this time in the Saddledome for our home opener. And once again, we were unable to get the best of the Oilers, despite outshooting them 35-29. We lost 5-3 in this one. The Flames had goals from Monahan, Frolik, Joki Paka were the three Flames that got goals. Joki Paka in the lineup this time, and Nick Grossman and Brett Kulak both out on the blue line. So, Matt, overall thoughts on the Flames' play in their home opener?
I thought, by and large, the team played well, and I think the Flames won the shot totals 35-28 or something like that.
35-29.
Okay, there you go. And by and large, most of the players had decent games. Like, you could still see that guys like Gaudreau and that their timing was a little off, but they were getting better. The one player, though, that had an absolutely horrific game was Dennis Wiedemann, and he was responsible for at least one of the goals against, and, you know, it was not surprising that he was benched after that.
Yeah, he had the least even strength time on ice of all defensemen at 16:05. Joki Paka had only 10 seconds more of regular strength time than he did, but they put Wiedemann out there a lot on the special teams. He played 3:09 on the power play and 2:16 on the shorthand, compared to Joki Paka's 45 seconds on the power play and 1:11 for the shorthand. To me, I think that they're trying to give Wiedemann every chance they can, but I think that he's quickly losing those chances. I think that we're going to see him probably be up in the press box before the end of this next week.
Yeah, and also in that game, Matt Stajan, he was on the penalty kill in the second period, and he completely left Jordan Eberle alone, allowing him to sneak in and score the tying goal in the second period. And at times, Stajan in the first three games has looked okay, but then there are other times where he's looked rather terrible.
That's kind of Stajan's MO since he's been a Flame, though, Matt. I mean, he'll go through periods where he'll score and he'll look good, and then he'll go back to just, you know, kind of being a cruddy fourth-line centerman.
Yeah. It's one of those things that having players like that, him and Wiedemann, playing regularly, like, if that continues, like, it may end up causing some points to be shed off of the Flames' total points on the season. And when you have other options like Garnett Hathaway and Freddie Hamilton that can play in those spots, or Joki Paka and Kulak, you know, will it be a true meritocracy this year where last year it was not?
Well, I think that, you know, both Stajan and Wiedemann have the NHL deals. I think it's their spots to lose. And, you know, Freddie Hamilton hasn't seen the ice yet for the Flames this season. But I really think that just like with Wiedemann, it's Stajan's job to lose, and I think he's quickly losing it. And I would not be surprised if we see Stajan out for at least one of the games this week and Freddie Hamilton put into his place. And as we've talked about, I think it's going to depend on what they want on that fourth line. I think that overall, Freddie's a better centerman for what you want your fourth line to be. But I think that for what both those guys are getting paid, you can't just sit them in the press box. You have to give them a chance.
Yeah. I could also see, because Michael Ferland has struggled in the three games as well, that the possibility of putting Stajan as the left winger on the fourth line and have Hamilton draw into the middle.
And that might not be too bad. I mean, Gullitson did tell Stajan to expect to play on the left wing this year. That might not be a bad line pairing, at least to see if we can get some out of Stajan if he's not the centerman. I think that being on the left wing, we don't have the same reliance on him and playing sort of the offensive way that we need him to as a centerman. The centerman's relied on to do a lot of things and to sort of play a lot more of the ice than the wingers usually. And maybe Hamilton would be better there. But you have to do something. I mean, you can't just leave these lines the way they are. Though we did see better lineups, more of what we're expecting in this second game. But yeah, it just looks like guys need, it almost just looks like we need some time to get warmed up, doesn't it?
Yeah, and with having a couple days off and allowing the team to practice, I'm sure that when they drop the puck against Buffalo tomorrow, that the team will actually look like they're putting the pieces together and getting that chemistry going.
Well, before we talk Buffalo, let's talk about the last game of the week. This is the first one that we were outshot in of the week. This was our game against our other foe on the road. We went to Vancouver for a back-to-back, and we saw the first start from Chad Johnson in this one. But the Flames lost 2-1, and we didn't even score a goal here. It was our first point of the season. Credited to Troy Brower, but it was in a Vancouver own goal, and I thought that was pretty fun to watch.
Yeah. Goal of the year candidate, for sure.
Well, I mean, it's one thing if you get, you know, like a New Jersey own goal against Calgary, but it means so much more when it's one of our rivals.
Yeah. And it's you like gotta the Steve feel Smith bad. Goal we yeah, all remember. You gotta feel bad though for Louis Erickson. Like, he just signed there for like a 5-year deal. First game, and the first shot that he has, he scores, but it's in his own net. Like, you know.
Either you feel bad for him or he goes back to the bench, the coach yells at him and he says, "Hey, I'm your problem for 5 years."
Yeah. And to his credit, he did have a very good game in the game. So
yeah, he bounced back pretty quick after that. And he, it's funny because they actually credited him for one assist on the Sedin goal. So he did get his point in the end. It wasn't the point he wanted, but he did get credit for the Sedin goal after all. At least an assist on that. So overall, I thought a better game. I thought that we closed some of the holes that we were seeing from the Flames in this game. Still not the game I want to be seeing, but it feels like it was an incremental change from the Vancouver game upwards.
Yeah.
What did you think?
Well, I thought that Vancouver really did not have many scoring chances in the contest. I think they only had about 4 or 5 quality chances, and the last one, of course, resulting in the equalizer. And while they outshot us, I thought the Flames did a very good job in keeping most of their shots to the perimeter, and not very difficult saves for Johnson in most of the cases. So I thought that aspect was good, because, you know, you can allow teams to take shots from the outside all you want. The goalie's likely going to stop most of them. It's those ones that are in close, like the Sedin goal, where you have to worry about, and we did a good job this week in limiting that, especially when they got the puck into our zone. It's just too many breakaways and odd man rushes, by and large.
I think the biggest thing that I have written down here from the week is the Flames are giving away too many pucks. I mean, they were credited with about 12 giveaways in the first game, 9 in the second game, and 8 in this game. And I think you could see when you're watching it that they're not controlling the puck well enough, and they're giving it to the other team, and that's going to kill you in the end.
Exactly. But, you know, they're adjusting to the new system, and things like that are going to happen. Not everybody's on the same page yet. You just have to give it some time to sort itself out.
The other thing that we heard from Gullitson when he came in as coach was that blocking shots was going to be a last resort for the Flames. We weren't going to be blocking nearly as many shots as we did last year. And if you look at the Vancouver game, we had 23 block shots we were credited with. So either the Flames are just having to work through this new system and get what they used to out of their head, or we actually lost control that many times. And I would say that we probably didn't, because Gullitson kind of said the block shots are the last resort if we've lost control in our own end. So I think a lot of this is just retraining these guys.
Yeah. And you can sort of see that certain players, like even a guy like Gaudreau, still has the instinct to flee the zone a little before he's supposed to, based on the system. And
remember that Gaudreau also didn't play any preseason here. So his first real, you know, look at the system, I bet, was on the plane right over after the contract was signed.
Yeah. So it's going to take a bit to just get all the ducks in a row, but I'm not overly concerned. I know some people out there are panicking about the start, like, oh, it's going to be a repeat of last year.
We've played 3 games. If you look on some of the online forums and Twitter, the sky is falling. The Flames have lost 3. What are we going to do? The way I look at it is 3 down, 79 to go. This team, and I'm not saying it's an excuse, but this team historically starts slow. And I think that if you look at our schedule, we have Buffalo and we have Carolina to get our legs under us. We've sort of got 2 more practice games, if you will, and then we've got to turn it up. And if we don't, we're going to get slaughtered very early on in the season. But I think that we're seeing enough, at least for me, we're seeing enough change every game, enough incremental improvement, that really, I think we can't talk about where this team is or what they look like until at least November 1st, when we have a good sampling of games under our belt.
Yeah, and you remember last year where guys like Giordano, Hamilton, and a handful of others, it took them a while to get going in terms of adapting to the system, and or in Giordano's case, recovering from the injury. And the whole team, we have a large amount of new players into the organization and a new system entirely. So between the two, like, not only are players having to adjust to playing with new line mates, like, say, Sam Bennett, he's now playing with two guys that he's never played with before, and making the adjustments to the new system, there's a lot of pieces in play where it just takes a while to get your rhythm going.
Yeah, and I think, too, I mean, I know this when I used to play hockey, is sometimes you sort of play to the team that you're against. You know, maybe they let their guard down a little bit against Edmonton in the first game. I think with Buffalo and Carolina, it'll be interesting to see how they look. But the real test of this team, I think, is going to be with St. Louis and Chicago later this month, and seeing how we look against teams that I think everybody agrees are probably playoff bound this year.
Yeah, and when you're playing against teams that are expected to be higher up in the draft lottery, like all of the teams that we've played, that's a lot different than teams that are actually vying for the Stanley Cup. And whether they can make adjustments or not will determine whether the Flames are done by November or not.
I don't think we can be done that early, man.
Well, out of all the teams that were terrible last year, only Anaheim actually made the playoffs, and that was because it's Anaheim, and they were uncharacteristically bad in the first month. It's one of those things that where the Flames pretty much were done once the first month of the season was last year, so they can't really have a repeat performance.
We talked a little bit about Stajan and potentially putting Hamilton in there. I don't see them making a call up on the forwards yet, but I think one of the interesting things to look at over the next seven games this month will be on the D and the defensemen they play. I mean, we have kind of a bottom four of Joki Paka, Kulak, Weidman, and Grossman. It's going to be interesting to see how they manage ice time there. Kulak hasn't got that much ice time yet, but I think that of those four, I think Joki Paka and Kulak are the guys to run with, and Weidman and Grossman should be scratched, at least going into the Buffalo game. What do you think, Matt?
I agree. And like in the first couple games, Weidman and Grossman had a number of mistakes that resulted in pucks in the Flames net. And that happens with any defenseman. You're going to, like, Giordano's going to make mistakes this year that result in goals against. Brody's going to do the same. Hamilton's going to do the same. That's life. But with your depth defenseman, you just simply can't have multiple goals going in the net because of their play. And you can handle it, though, a little better if you've got younger defensemen that are learning how to improve. And with Joki Paka and Kulak, they're both young NHL defensemen just breaking into the league. So, a lot, you know, if they do make mistakes that result in goals against, you can at least chalk it up to growing pains and hoping that they'll actually learn, where guys like Weidman and Grossman are likely on their last NHL contracts. So it's not the same thing.
I think on a team that's supposed to be competitive this year, you also have to look at kind of playing your way into the lineup. If I look at this team, okay, I understand putting Weidman and Grossman out there in the first game. They're the veteran guys. To me, Grossman played his way out of a position, and Weidman played his way out of a position. Not saying they will all year. I still think Grossman is going to be a good number seven defenseman here. I don't think we can judge him on one game and say this is a terrible signing, but I think that Joki Paka and Kulak, I mean, Kulak's a young kid, so if they're going to keep him up, he needs to play. He's not going to be effective to anybody if he's sitting in the press box. And if that's the way they want to go, send him back to Stockton. I don't think they'll get much out of him there, but at least he'll play hockey, which is what they're paying him to do. But I think right now, Joki Paka and Kulak played their way into the lineup, and I think, you know, it's going to be almost now the coach is talking to Weidman, Grossman.
Yeah,
saying,
and you also got to remember that Brett Kulak, we need to figure out what the heck we have in him as a defenseman. And you look on the Stockton Heat, you have Rasmus Anderson and Oliver Shillington. they're both playing well. They played well in their first game this past weekend. And those guys are going to be pushing for spots in the NHL next year. And they could very well take spots in the NHL next year. Well, what do you do if with Kulak then, if those two do actually cement themselves in the NHL lineup next year? You just don't know what you have. So if you can know via playing him on a regular basis this season what you have in Kulak, like, does he have the potential to become a number four defenseman, which does look actually possible, then you can make those adjustments of, okay, if you lose Joki Paakka in the expansion draft, then you can put Kulak in his spot with Hamilton, and, you know, if you have Shillington or Anderson play as a 5-6, then, you know, you can make those adjustments, but...
And the only way to find that out is going to be to put Kulak on the ice.
Exactly, and he'll either sink or swim, but you have to actually give him the opportunity, and in the past, we've given Wotherspoon opportunities, and he hasn't really taken advantage of them, and he did actually play rather poorly on the weekend, but you're not going to see him likely back in the lineup anytime soon, so... Kulak did take the most of it and has pushed his way into the lineup. Now let's see where he can actually slot in moving forward.
And I think we're going to know what happens with Kulak by probably about Remembrance Day, which is 15 games in the season. I mean, if he's not playing, you send him back down. It doesn't mean he's banished forever, but you got to get this guy on the ice. Whether it's at the NHL level or the AHL level, you can't evaluate a guy for eating hot dogs. That's not what you're paying him to do in the press box. So he needs to be playing. And I think that right now, I mean, they kept him on the roster for a reason. They obviously see something in him. And I think that you've just got to play him. I think it's the last time we see Joki Paakka sitting out was that first game, unless he plays terribly. I think that Joki Paakka and Kulak are sort of by default in there, and Weidman and Grossman are on their way back in. I still think Weidman is not going to be a Flame come the end of the year. But it's going to be tough to find a buyer, and I think that maybe the Flames were sort of auditioning him in the first couple games to see what they could get for a buyer for him.
Well, I think that's why you saw him paired with Giordano even in the preseason for a bit.
That's kind of what I was thinking too, yeah.
And no, but there was no takers, so...
Well, I think for a contract like that, it's tough to move in the preseason. Teams want to kind of wait for their opening day roster and see how much money they have left and how much we'd have to eat. So I would expect that deal to happen if it's going to happen before the deadline. I'd say probably in the next month or so.
Well, even if it takes until the trade deadline itself, like the Flames, if they're eating half of the contract, it's only going to be about $1 million as a cost to the team acquiring them in terms of the cap. So it's not that big of a deal.
We had somebody, I'd have to look up who it was, somebody who... or sent a tweet to us after last week and said, do you think that Weidman may be the first Flame to be waived?
I could see that.
I don't think they'll send him down to Stockton.
Well, they can't. He has a no movement clause, but I could see them waiving him just to see
if... Waive him. If somebody wants to take the money, have him.
Yeah.
If you want to take on his contract, we'll give him to you for nothing. It's our gift to you. Remember it later.
Yep.
It's like one of those trades for future considerations, right? I'll buy you some waffles when you're in town if you take Weidman.
Yeah. And, you know, additionally, you could even say to Weidman, like, you can either stay in the press box up here, or you can at least go down to Stockton.
Well, that's it. He can waive that no move, I believe.
Yeah. But it's up to him. And I don't see the Flames bothering to play him unless either Joki Paakka or Kulak struggle or there's injuries.
Yeah, I think Weidman's been here for a few years. We know what we've got in Weidman. It's not like Grossman, who's new. You know, it's not like he's a brand new Flame. He's been here for a while. We know what we've got in Weidman. I don't think that there's any reason you need to say, well, let's play him in a couple more just to see. I think we know exactly where we're at. We got lots of tape on him. I imagine the coaches can watch. And I think that Weidman's almost our default number seven now, and Grossman becomes number eight.
Doesn't hurt.
Do you think that Grossman would be above Weidman in the depth chart or below?
It depends on who is getting yanked from the game. Like, if, say, England gets banged up or has a really bad game, yeah, then I'd put Grossman in because he's that style of defenseman. If any of the other five get hurt or struggle, then Weidman goes in.
So we talked earlier about this team and the schedule and what next week looks like. And Matt, you were doing some looking at the schedule, and it's going to be a tough run for the Flames if they keep struggling. We have Buffalo and Carolina coming up this week. Then after that, 12 of the next 14 games are against teams that are expected to be elite NHL teams this year.
Yeah, it's going to be really tough for the Flames if they don't get their act together soon. After the Carolina game, the first three games after that are a pair against St. Louis, sandwiched around a game against Chicago. And not only that,
you got a back-to-back there. So we have St. Louis and Calgary on a Saturday. Then on Monday, we're in Chicago. And then the next day, Tuesday, we have a back-to-back against St. Louis. So you see them twice, but it's, you know, three games in 4 days there against really tough teams.
Yeah, and if the Flames say they only get 2 points out of the Carolina-Buffalo games, that would not be good. They really do need to win both. And
I think you at least need to come away with 1 point in each.
Yeah, like it's going to be tough, especially moving beyond that. And if Calgary doesn't get their act together fairly quickly, especially if they struggle during that 14-game stretch, like that gets you to the 19th game of the season. If they're below a point per game at that point, I think the season's done. And after that, like if they can survive that 14-game stretch, like the next 3 months are all mostly easier games against easier teams where you're not playing guys like Anaheim, LA, San Jose, Chicago, St. Louis, Washington repetitively. Like there's a couple of games here and there against teams like Dallas, but it's not constantly good team after good team after good team after good team. So
I mean, looking at those first games you're talking about, we have St. Louis, Chicago, St. Louis that we talked about. We have a game against Ottawa. I don't think Ottawa is necessarily going to be as hard as we think they're going to be, at least this early.
Yeah, that's one of the easier ones.
Washington's going to be a tough game on the 30th. And then we see Chicago again. San Jose, LA. No, I mean, right now LA is the only team below us that could go either way that game. Then we have our first game in Anaheim, which is, I think we can pencil in as a loss right now. Dallas, the Rangers, Minnesota, Arizona, Chicago, Detroit, and then again on November 21st, we play Buffalo, and I think that kind of, it's weird, because Buffalo sort of starts the run of must wins and sort of ends the run of must wins.
Yeah. So it's not going to exactly be the most fun stretches for the Flames from now until basically November 18th, but at least the Flames will have an opportunity beyond that until basically March to make up some ground. It's going to be a really tough stretch for the first 20 games or so.
And I was looking at the schedule before we came on the air tonight. Anyone who hasn't looked at it, you should go take a look. It's a weird schedule this year. It almost seems really compressed, like it's an Olympic year, but it's not. A lot of back-to-backs. I think that's because of the new mandated week off. They have to compress everything. But I mean, if we look at October, we have two sets of back-to-backs already in October. We have two in November. A lot of away games in November. December is sort of a weird month. And then if you look at, you and I were looking at this earlier, if you look at March, the Flames are playing at home almost every other day in March. Like there's only 4 away games, I think, and 10 home games in 1 month. So March is going to be busy.
Yeah,
but
March.
It's just a really weird schedule this year.
Yeah, well, from March 9th right through the end of the season, the Flames literally play every other day for the rest of the year. So,
and that's when your guys are banged up already and playing that kind of schedule, they get even more banged up. So that's where rushing to the playoffs, you got to have guys ready to be called up.
And that's why it's so important, especially through the next stretch and the 3 months after that, to bank a lot of points. So that way, when the real grind happens in March, that they'll have a good chance to actually push for a playoff spot instead of being buried.
And I mean, the Flames have these rest periods this year sort of built in. They have the last week of January, as is mandated this year. For those that don't know, teams are entitled to, I think, 5 days off where there's no practices, no games of any kind. So ours is January 27th through the 30th. And then again in February, we have this stretch from the 8th to the 12th off. And I think to myself, like, I'm not a scheduler in the NHL, but could we not stick one game in there and give us less back-to-back somewhere? It's just, it's going to be an odd schedule this year. And I think that if, like you said, if the Flames don't come out hard at the beginning, it's going to be like a boulder and it's going to get bigger and bigger and harder to keep climbing up that mountain. And yeah, we have to be consistent very quickly. And coming off three games where this team played subpar, it's not looking great. But I don't want to judge anything yet. I want to give them till at least the end of the month.
I agree.
I mean, if you look around us, we're not the only team struggling. And I think this is an important thing to point out, too. It's not like, you know, some people have said, oh, well, the Oilers are above us and we're below them. And yes, that's true. But I mean, if you look at the Western Conference standings, you have Anaheim and us tied in LA with 0 points. I don't think anyone would probably say that Anaheim, Calgary, and LA all missed the playoffs this year. We're three games in. Weird
yeah.
things happened at the beginning. Vancouver and Edmonton are third and fourth. Anaheim and LA are 12th and 14th. So, you know, there's still 79 games to play. There's a lot of hockey for this to shake down. And I think it's too early to say, oh, let's write this season off already.
Yeah. Like, you and I both penciled in Anaheim, San Jose, us, and LA as the top four teams in our division. And realistically, we only have to beat one of those teams. You're not going to see Vancouver winning all 82 games. They're 2-0 right now.
Not going to see Edmonton winning, you know, probably going 500 this year.
No. All of the teams that, like Arizona, they're not very good. The Flames just have to, over the remaining 79 games, beat out Anaheim, San Jose, and Los Angeles. And we're tied with Anaheim after three games, and we're a point ahead of LA with... they have a game in hand. Okay, well, that's not that big of a deal to push forward. We only have to beat one of them. So, it's not a big deal. It's just that moving forward, they have to turn their game up so that way they can start putting points up on the board.
It's going to be interesting to see how they react over the next week for sure. But, you know, on the good side, not everything's looking bad. Matt, you were doing some look at the Corsi stats. Do you want to tell everyone about your findings there?
Yeah, the Flames are currently in the top 10 in the Corsi 4 percentage, which is basically all the shot attempts for minus the shots attempts against. And the Flames are one of the top 10 teams in that regard. And that generally helps to indicate that the team's doing fairly well in terms of controlling the play in the games. I'm not a huge fan of the Corsi numbers because I don't think they go quite deep enough, but the Flames last year were 23rd in that regard. And
23rd out of 30.
Yeah, and they've constantly struggled since we went into the rebuild mode. So the fact that the Flames are in the top 10 in that stat, they're also in the PDO stat, which is the basically luck factor, the Flames are currently dead last in that regard. So showing that this team is actually better than what they showed in terms of the actual on-ice results. And you can see that in the first two games against Edmonton, they controlled the play for the majority of the game. It's just that they didn't quite convert enough chances. And when you let McDavid have that many breakaways, you're going to get burned. And that happens.
I'm not a huge Corsi guy, but is there a luck stat?
Well, that's what PDO is.
I'd call that like the leprechaun stat.
Yeah, well, pretty much.
So, I mean, the fact that we're, and again, we're three games in, but the fact that we're trending upwards in some of these, that's not the only one that we're near the top in that, but we're trending up in a lot of different Corsi stats just looking at the numbers here. So I think when you look at this roster and you look at the players on this roster, there's no way we can be as low as we are right now, and it's just a matter of waiting for these guys to get fired up.
Yeah, And we saw in the Vancouver game, the defense pairing stabilized significantly and limited a lot of chances. If they can continue to work as a team on the defense and prevent a lot of chances, then that naturally will allow the Flames to have the puck more, and especially winning more faceoffs as they have in the first three games. That'll allow them to play that puck control game that they need to play in order to be successful. And the goals will come. It's just frustrating when, you know, you're wanting them to be good right out of the gate and they struggle a bit.
Moving away from the Flames in the last week, let's talk about some organizational things, potentially some better highlights there. The Flames made a free agent signing this week. They brought in yet another goaltender. They brought in Tom McCollum, who comes to us from the Detroit system. He was actually, I didn't realize this, he was a first-round pick, Detroit's 30th overall in the 2008 NHL draft, and a guy who's played a lot of his career in the minors. He's played, I think, three career NHL games so far, so not a huge look at this guy, but Matt, you've seen more of him. I didn't see any of his NHL games last year, the few that he played. What's your read on McCollum?
He's not a bad goaltender. He's fairly a standard backup AHL goaltender, NHL goaltender. Like, he's adequate. He's not going to blow you away with any highlight reel saves or anything like that. He's just okay. And last year in the AHL, he put up a 242 goals against average and a 923 save percentage. And that pretty much falls in line with where he's been the last couple of years. Just when you have the goaltending depth that the Red Wings have between Howard and Mrazek, you're just not going to get the opportunities to move forward beyond that. Having him as AHL depth with Stockton, that will allow Gillies more of an opportunity to start, and having the ability to have a reliable backup in case Gillies gets hurt or if you have multiple games and multiple day situations.
It's interesting if you look at the Flames goaltending, they really revamped, of all the positions, they really revamped this one in the summer. I mean, we had three goalies in Ordio, Hiller, and Ramo who were gone. And the new goaltending lineup, if you look at the Flames goalies who are pro, is Brian Elliott, Chad Johnson, John Gillies, David Rittich, Tom McCollum, Mason McDonald, Nick Schneider, and Tyler Parsons, who doesn't have a contract yet. But really, I mean, they've changed that whole lineup up. And looking at that group, I don't think McCollum ever plays, unless we go through another crazy season where we need like nine goalies. I don't think McCollum ever wears a Flames jersey.
The only way it would happen is if one of the NHL goalies gets hurt and Gillies can't play for whatever reason.
Even then, I think they might bring McDonald or Rittich up first.
No, I think McCollum would, just because really? He's more veteran guy. He's 26, so, you know, he's more in that Joey McDonald class.
So I guess the interesting position this puts the Flames in now is, as of right now, they have three goaltenders assigned to Stockton. They have John Gillies, Dave Rittich, and Tom McCollum. I can't see them wanting to sit one of those guys for most of the games. How do you think that shakes down? There's no question in my mind 22-year-old John Gillies is the starter. We went into this thinking David Rittich is his backup. Do you still think that's going to happen, or what do you think happens with Rittich and McCollum?
No, I think McCollum takes the backup spot for now. And
you think Rittich goes down and backs up McDonald in the ECHL?
That's the most likely scenario, because I don't think there's any need to have three goalies in Stockton for a long time. Like, keep them there for a bit. Like, have McCollum and Rittich practice with each other, so that way you can see who's the better of the two. The winner takes the backup spot, the other guy goes to the E.
Yeah, it could be, and I wouldn't be surprised even sending Rittich to the E just to start with, because he's just coming over to North America. That might even help him get a handle on the North American game.
Yeah.
So for those that do watch Stockton games, Tom McCollum will be wearing number 30, and he's the third left-handed goaltender we have down there, so all lefties playing there. But, you know, it's never hurts to have more goalie depth. And I really think there's a Kevin Poulin-like signing. You bring in a guy who's got some experience at that level, not a lot of NHL experience, still hungry there, but His contract expires after 2017-2018. He'll be a UFA. Unless he does fantastic things, I don't think McCollum comes back. But I think it's a good depth signing for now. He's also, as of right now, the only goaltender on the Flames roster who's expansion draft eligible. And I think that might have had something to do with signing him as well.
I think that's the main reason why he's a Flame. And it's a good thing to have that kind of depth. And especially with McCollum being at the age of 26, that's usually when goaltenders figure it out. And having a goaltender that has pretty much consistently had good statistics when he's played in the AHL, you might end up actually seeing him evolve into being a quality NHL backup at some point.
I just don't think he's going to get enough ice time during his time as a Flame to really be able to take that next step.
It's one of those things that you can always evaluate and see how he does in Stockton and evaluate, because you have him for 2 years, and why not see what you have? And if he rises to the occasion, maybe there's a spot for him as the backup after his 2 year contract is up, or you just have him there for the 2 years and move on.
Wouldn't that be weird to go from an Elliot Johnson pairing to a Gillies McCollum pairing?
Stranger things have happened.
And we also don't know what we're going to get out of John Gillies the year after his big injury. I mean, we're all hoping he's going to bounce back. We hope he's going to be okay. But we don't know what to expect there. And this, I think, might be a bit of an insurance marker, too, in that, you know what, if Gillies isn't ready, then we can go with a Riddich-McCollum pairing, or we can make McCollum the starter until Gillies gets his feet under him. It just gives us more options, and we'll wait and see how it turns out. But you know, with Gillies, Riddich, McCollum, and McDonald as our four goalies to split between the AHL and the ECHL, you've got a lot of options here. And I think that you'll see a lot of movement between these four throughout the year.
I agree.
Even McDonald, who's playing in the ECHL, he's looking good so far. You might see him get called up, like you're saying, on a weekend when they might have three games in a row, just see how he looks. But it's just totally weird to me how they've totally revamped this position. I mean, the only guys who were here last year were Gillies, McDonald, Schneider, and everyone else has changed. And it's fascinating that we found so many goalies so quickly to fill this spot. You could never do that with any other position, I don't think.
No, and the fact is that there's a number of quality goaltenders around the world. So, and there's only so many spots for all of these players, so when the Flames are saying, hey, we have five spots open, well, you're going to fill them rather quickly. So,
well, we're talking about guys in the AHL and the ECHL. Stockton Heat have started their season, and there's some interesting developments down there. Matt, you were looking at Stockton over the weekend. Do you want to tell us how they looked?
Yeah, they played their nemesis, the San Jose Barracuda. And
isn't that weird? Like, Calgary and the Sharks are nemesis, but yet the farm teams are. It's just because of regional demographics, but it's weird to hear.
Well, plus the Barracuda mopped the floor with Stockton all of last season.
That's true.
So I think they only won one game against San Jose that entire year after playing like 10 games against them. So, you know, at least they got off to a winning start. San Jose opened the scoring off a turnover by Kenny Morrison. He shot the puck right into the guy who ended up streaking in for a breakaway and scoring.
Sounds like a Canucks move.
Pretty much, yeah. And after that, the Flames turned it around. They got the equalizer off of a turnover caused by Andrew Mangiapane. And then a few minutes after that, Jankowski made a very swift move in the offensive zone to strip the puck off of the defender and then pass it behind himself to Shinkarik for a goal. And Wamberg gave the Flames the lead again late in the contest. The Heat, my bad. Late in the contest, just with his speed, he intercepted the play from the defender and all in one motion lifted the guy's stick and flipped the puck over the goalie before he had a chance to react. And they ended up winning the game 3-2. In the contest, the players that I noted that played well were the entire first line of Jankowski, Shinkaruk, and Hathaway. They were dangerous every shift. Jankowski was the best player on that line by a wide margin, but each of them contributed well. Ryan Lomberg threw a number of hits in the game, scored
the game. He was also named the first star of the game.
Yeah, and played well on the penalty kill and scored the game-winning goal. Mangiapane, he played the exact game that you would expect from him if you've watched him. Just a very tenacious style of game. And one thing of good news for people that have been wondering what was going to happen with Emile Poirier, he actually looked very much like he did in his first season in the AHL, was generating a lot of scoring chances, using his speed to his advantage, being in the right places at the right time in the offensive zone, had a number of quality scoring chances, could not beat...
He was credited with 3 shots.
Yeah, and he couldn't beat the goaltender, but he looked more like the Poirier that we saw in the first year that he was in the AHL instead of the mediocre season that he had last year. And on defense, both Oliver Shillington and Rasmus Anderson played well. Shillington, he did turn over the puck a couple of times, but he recovered the puck from the guy that he turned the puck over to each time, and they did not generate a single scoring chance off of any of his turnovers, and he's looking a lot more composed defensively. And, of course, Jonathan Gillies in the net looked very solid, was giving up a few rebounds, but, you know, that's to be expected. For players that struggled, the defensive pairing of Tyler Wotherspoon and Kenny Morrison were off most of the night. Morrison with a bit of a mistake that led to the opening goal. Other than that, nobody was overtly terrible, either up front or on the blue line.
And we'll give the same qualifier we gave talking about the Flames earlier. This is game one. So, you know, it's good to see guys like Poirier looking good, but there's a long season down there as well, and it'll really depend how they do going forward.
Yeah. And Daniel Preble, it's the first time I've got to see him play in a game, and he played in the middle instead of on right wing, and he was solid. He had a couple of decent plays, nothing too good, but nothing too bad either.
But we also see with a guy like Preble every year that they take some time to adjust to the North American game, so that doesn't surprise me hearing that.
Yeah, not bad. He would fit right in the middle of the top 6 forwards on Stockton.
What I was surprised to see reading the stats on this one, the number 2 star of the game who got 2 shots, Brandon Bolig, who wears number 25 for the Stockton Heat. So, I mean, we've seen at the NHL level, he has some offensive ability, not a lot, but again, if it's going to stay or not, we don't know if he's going to stay as an offensive force there or you know, kind of fade off into the sunset. But good to see that he got a second star in his first game, and that shows he's probably trying to fight his way back to the NHL.
Yeah, he was a little bit more enthusiastic in this game, and like you could tell he was an NHL caliber player, where a lot of the players are more, you can tell that they're AHL talents.
Well, just some seasoning, right? Yeah. Bolig's got some seasoning.
Yeah. It doesn't mean that he's going to be a good NHL player, but you know what I mean? Like, he is what he is.
He's also a guy who can't decide what number he wants on his back. When he was in Chicago, he was 52. He came to Calgary when they had that dumb 0 to 30 numbers rule, and he was 25. Then he switched back to 52. Now he's 25 again on the farm.
Why not?
Like, it's the same 2 numbers, you're just flipping them around. I would expect that he would have worn 52, so it's weird to see that he's wearing 25. I always think of 25 as like an elite sniper number. I don't know about you.
Well, years of Neuendijk will do that for you.
I think that's probably what I'm used to. So it's weird to see, you know, the enforcer wearing 25. But good to see over the first game that we're getting some of these guys, you know, guys like Shinkaruk having a good game, Jankowski having a good game, Hathaway, Shillington, all the guys that we're expecting to have a really good game were doing well. And good to see that you thought Anderson was doing well, because the biggest knock on Anderson's always been his conditioning, so I wasn't sure what to expect with him at the beginning of the year.
Oh, for sure. He was just very composed on the ice, not inefficient in his play. So we'll see how that continues. Stockton plays twice this week, a game against the Texas Stars and the Tucson Roadrunners Wednesday and Friday.
You can guess whose farm teams those are. Texas Stars is Dallas's farm team, and Tucson is Arizona's farm team. So, you know, we'll see what happens. Matt will keep bringing us updates there. I'm going to be curious to see what Preble can do, if he's just another David Wolf type who comes over, doesn't do much, and leaves again. Or I think that he has, I don't think he's going to break out to be like a top six NHLer, but I think he could end up being a depth NHL guy. It's just going to take some time to get his legs under him. And Jankowski, Poirier, Shinkarik, those are guys to watch as well down there, because I think those are our next generation Flames.
Yeah, and there was, of all of the players in the Stockton lineup, Jankowski and Shillington looked like NHL players, whereas everybody else was not quite as good. Like, if you had to slot any of the guys in, those two would be the number one choice in either spot for forward or defense.
Good to know. So we got a really interesting piece of fan mail this week. We got an email to our inbox from a gentleman named Renee, and Renee lives in New Hampshire and has all of his life. And we actually have a lot of fans, our listeners might not know this, who listen to the podcast outside of Calgary. We've heard from people in Sweden and Finland. We've heard from people in Switzerland and now New Hampshire. And a lot of people say that they can't get Flames hockey. Like he's saying, in New Hampshire, there is no Flames hockey. So this is how they stay in touch with the team. And I'm always really curious to know, how does somebody from, say, New Hampshire or Sweden or Finland become a Flames fan? And I just wanted to share this because this is sort of an interesting story from Renee. I asked him how he became a Flames fan. He said, it's a funny story how I became a Flames fan, actually. When I was a kid, me, my dad, and my brother would play NHL 99 on the Nintendo 64, and I would always choose the Flames because of their flaming horse jerseys, which I thought was a dragon for the longest time. So I started liking the Flames then, but it was in 2004 when I really fell in love with them. In 04, I got to watch basically every game during the playoffs, getting full exposure to Iggy, Kipper, Jelena, and the Sea of Red. Yeah, they really got exciting to watch. Love the players and the fans who were so passionate, and it was hard not to become a Flames fan. Ever since then, I've been following the Flames as closely as I can. So I just thought this was interesting because here's a guy who actually liked the horse jersey. Everyone in Calgary hated it, and this guy liked the Flames. He thought he was a dragon at first, but that's what drew him to the Flames. So, you know, as much as we lamented, there's obviously some people who love that jersey.
Well, that logo as a shoulder patch would not have been a bad thing. It's just as the main logo, yeah.
But even then, nobody falls in love with shoulder patches. I mean, do you know what I mean? They go, I really like this team shoulder patch.
Well, a lot of people like the third jersey with the script logos.
Yeah, but I think we'd like anything that wasn't flags.
True.
I mean, for years we had no shoulder patch. It was really, I think when we had the horse, correct me if I'm wrong, we put the flaming C on the shoulder, and I think that was the first time we really had a shoulder patch.
Yeah, it was.
So the flags to me always felt like they were just thrown at the last minute. We need something. Let's put flags on there. So I think that, yeah, I mean, it would make an okay shoulder patch, but it's just, you know, it's weird to kind of hear that he became a Flames fan because of that jersey. So that's cool. So Renee, welcome to the Sea of Red. We hope that you keep following the Flames, and it sounds like you, like Matt and I, have been here through thick and thin. I remember playing NHL 99, and it's weird if you ever go back and look at screenshots from those games. I don't know if you played them, Matt, but how far hockey games have come in that time.
Yeah. Although my favorite was like NHL 92 on
really?
The Sega Genesis. Yeah, that was like the really old school ones.
Well, I remember, I think it was 97 where they first started to get actual player detail. And I remember having it for the PC, and it had to be reinstalled. It crashed all the time. My dad was always reinstalling it for me, like every night after he got home from work. And I think you can still find that one out there somewhere. And I actually found out recently, NHL 2004, there's a whole community out there that have kept the game up to date and changed the graphics and that sort of thing. So I want to see if I can get myself a copy of NHL 2004 to go back and try that. Because to me, when I think of 2004, I'm thinking this game's going to be old and, you know, not look very good, but apparently they've done some amazing stuff with it. So it's cool those games still have some life. And 04 would have been about, yeah, that would have been probably the game the Flames would have still had the horse jersey in. Because we retired that in 05, didn't we?
Yeah, no, 06-07, I think.
Was it? Oh, okay.
No, yeah, something like that. 05.
Did they wear it during the cup run?
That year, yeah, in the first year after the lockout, if I recall correctly.
I think you might be right. I will check on it while we're going. But Renee also said that he was going to go to the Adirondack Thunder versus Manchester Monarchs game that was close to him. That's our ECHL affiliate. And he would give us a report on that. So I'll be curious to hear from him how some of those guys are looking. So it was in 2000, the Flames unveiled the horse jersey. In 2000 and 2003, it became the full-time away jersey, which is where they wore dark at the time. And then it was 2003 to 2006 that it was a third jersey. So that was the third jersey. And I believe it got retired right after that. But let me just double check. That seems about right. It was 2006, 2007 we retired it. Thank goodness. But hey, it's cool to hear that somebody came to the team because of that. Another piece of interesting news about uniforms, I guess, is the new hardest working Flames hat for the year. They always change that hat up. Was it last year's the fire hat?
Yes.
And it's been other things before that. A lot of Flames fans from the 04 run are going to remember when it was the green hard hat. This year, they've decided to go with a policeman's hat. And there's actually a video on calgaryflames.ca where you can watch the cops presenting this hat. But it's not the usual hat that you would get, the one we think of for policemen. It's the policeman's cowboy hat, which I believe is what they wear, like the beat cops and stuff, when they're walking on the streets. I think it's more seen as more casual, but someone could correct me on that. So that's kind of cool that there's that alliance between the police and the Flames, and hopefully that hat's going to bring them some luck this year. And speaking of hardworking Flames, some of the hardest working Flames are the ones we haven't seen yet. We have some Flames who are still within their various junior systems, the WHL, the OHL, the NCAA, ECHL, and playing in Europe, who have been working hard so far in the season. We've been so focused on the Flames, we haven't spent a lot of time talking about some of these younger players, some of them that we didn't even see at training camp. So I've pulled some of these guys just to look at what they've done so far, and there's some impressive stats. Matthew Phillips, who was drafted this year, he's played 8 games for the Victoria Royals of the WHL. He's got 10 points already, 6 goals and 4 assists. I don't know how Phillips usually does. I don't know how much you know about him, but is he usually a team leader? That's pretty impressive to get
started.
Well,
that was he was one of the top scorers in the WHL last year.
Was
so
he? Okay.
That's not with his size, that was the reason why he was a 6th-round pick instead of higher up.
Yeah, I just knew he was a late-round pick.
Yeah.
Nick Schneider for the Medicine Hat Tigers is 5-1-1 so far with a 2.42 GAA and a 9.915 save percentage. I'm still not sold on Schneider. I think he was sort of signed as depth, but he's looking better every year, and I think that if he keeps going upwards, Schneider could be a guy that sees a long future as a, I don't want to say the next Leland Irving because that sounds bad, but I think he's a guy that could be in the Flames system for a while, like Irving was.
Well, you got to look at
kind of flirting with the NHL.
Well, every once in a while, weird stuff happens, and you find a top quality goaltender as a walk on free agent signing. And you just have to look at the San Jose Sharks starting goaltender in the Stanley Cup Finals last year. He signed in the exact manner that Nick Schneider did with the Los Angeles Kings. And he obviously has become a very good starter and went to the Cup Final. So things can happen like that. Whether that happens or not for him, like where he becomes an NHL goaltender, we just have to wait and see. But the early returns, at least, he's showing decent. And hopefully there's more to him moving forward.
In the OHL, playing for the London Knights, the team that Tkachuk is from, we have our goaltender Tyler Parsons, who's 2-1-1 with a 3.44 GAA and a .871 save percentage. Parsons isn't a guy, honestly, that I watched a lot last year, but just being that he's a Flames prospect now, I'm going to be watching him more closely. I think he's the more interesting of him and Schneider, and I'm going to be really interested to see where he goes this year and what he does. Couple other guys that we'll talk about. We'll skip some of the other prospects playing in the NCAA. Their season really hasn't got started yet. But in the ECHL, our second-level affiliate, we have Mason McDonald down there. He's 2-0-0 so far, so he's got 2 wins under his belt. He has a 2.88 GAA and a .87 save percentage. And I'm expecting a really good year out of Mason McDonald at the ECHL level. I think there's a kid who has something to prove down there. I think you're going to see McDonald fighting his way back up to the AHL. Whether he gets many starts there or not, this guy's got something to prove.
Well, Mason McDonald just needs to have himself a good season, whether it's in the ECHL or not.
Just take the starts you can get and play as much hockey as you can get in the net for.
Exactly. And he's been kind of inconsistent throughout the time since the Flames picked him. So just getting a number of games in and playing well is the important thing. All the other concerns are irrelevant, and hopefully he can cement himself as a starter in the AHL next year, under the assumption that Gillies is the NHL backup, and go from there.
And I think that the fact they just signed McCollum gives him one more guy he's going to have to jump past. But, I mean, you're right, he's been a little bit inconsistent, but I think he's got the drive it's going to take to do it. If anyone's going to jump from the ECHL to a starter in the A on our depth chart, I think it's going to be McDonald.
Yep.
Brett Pollock's down there as well. Pollock's one of the guys that came over in the Russell for Joki Paka deal, and he's got one assist in two games. So I saw part of the game online. It's hard to see ECHL hockey in Calgary. From what I saw, Pollock's looking about what I expect him to be. He was not the centerpiece in that deal. But I think that Pollock is going to be another prospect that could surprise us.
Well, that's why you get as many prospects in there as you can. And some will disappoint, others will not. And if Pollock doesn't actually become anything, we still have Joki Paka and Dylan Dubé. So,
oh, that's right. We got Dubé in that too.
Yeah, so...
Well, we got the pick that became Dubé.
Yeah.
And then a couple guys over in Europe. Karnikov, who's sort of been an on and off prospect, has 4 goals and 6 assists and 10 points in 8 games. He's playing the VHL. Where's that? Is that...
That's the KHL's AHL.
Okay. So that's a Russian league.
Yeah. Or... They're AHL.
Okay. So they're kind of farm league. And KHL, too, we have Russian Rafikov, who, I don't know, I think this guy, I mean, we can't get him over to North America, so I don't think he's going to be a Flame for much longer, but he has 4 assists in 20 games, and I was shocked to hear that they played 20 games already. That season must start, like, mid-August. That's an early season, at least for us. I mean, mid-August, we're not even thinking hockey yet, and they've probably played a few games, so... Just an update on some of the Flames' prospects and where they're at. We've been watching the NHL team. But Matt, looking back at the NHL team now, let's profile the week ahead. We have 3 games this week, 3 very important games this week for the Flames. We've talked about them already. It's all home games this week, a 3-game homestand for the Flames. Tomorrow night on the 18th, the Buffalo Sabres are in town for 7 p.m. start time. On Thursday the 20th, the Carolina Hurricanes are in town, again a 7 p.m. start time. And on Saturday, the St. Louis Blues visit us, and that's going to be an 8 p.m. start time. 6 points on the table, 4 points that are easy, and 2 that are going to be hard. What's your prediction?
I'm going to actually go with 4 points. 2 wins, one against Carolina and 1 against St. Louis. I think that they're going to struggle against Buffalo just due to... perhaps not being 100% together yet, but I think they'll figure it out in time for Carolina.
I'm going to be a little more pessimistic this week. I think they're going to get 2 points. I think they're going to win against Buffalo. I think watching Buffalo, they don't really have their stuff together yet either. So I think they'll win against Buffalo. I think it's going to be a tough go against Carolina, and I think that the St. Louis Blues are going to just run away with us. I'm worried about that game. I think that could be quite a high score for the Blues. If we keep playing the way we have been, I think the Blues are going to just take that one. And just a note on this week, it's expected that Chad Johnson may get the start against the Sabres. By the time this shows out, everyone will know if he did or not, but that's his old team. It would make sense. You know, I mean, we're still early in the season. Why not give him another start?
Yep.
And looking back at how we did last week in the predictions, we had 6 points on the table. The Flames got 1 of them. I thought we'd get 2 with a win over Edmonton. You thought we'd get 5 of them, that we'd lose to Edmonton, or that we'd lose to Edmonton, get an overtime win in Calgary, and a win in Vancouver. And we both ended up getting skunked, and it's 0-0 now going into the second week.
Yeah, well, I would expect us to be right very few times this season. I think
last year we did terrible, Matt.
I know. Well, I'm expecting a similar stretch of results this year.
I think at least at the beginning here, it's going to be tough for us to figure out what the results are going to be until we see who the Flames are as a team. I think until we get this team on the ice and playing the way they need to, we don't know what's going to happen. I mean, this week I could easily see them walking away with 4 points, and I could easily see them walking away with 0 points. It'd be devastating if it's zero. We need those points right now.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, could you imagine the freakout if it was 0 points? Like, I think everybody would be like...
People would be calling for Gullitson's head already.
Pretty much. Well, that's why the Flames have two NHL coaches. You know, they got Cameron as well, so...
Yeah, and even Paul... I'm trying to think of his last name. The other guy. He could be an associate coach, too. But, yeah, you're right. I mean, Dave Cameron could step in. We're getting so much freak out after three games. I can't imagine if we go, you know, the first six games of the season with no wins.
Yeah, I think that, like, everybody would be freaking out and like, okay, let's... trade off this guy and this guy and this guy and this guy and
that people
guy.
Trying to trade their Flames jerseys for Oilers jerseys.
Pretty much.
It's going to be a weird week, though. I mean, they've Buffalo and Carolina. I mean, but so should have Edmonton been guaranteed wins. And when Edmonton's lighting you up 7-4, I'm scared of what St. Louis could do to us.
Yeah. Well, it'll be interesting. The Flames are going to have to make some adjustments so that way this season doesn't get away from them.
And I think you mentioned it earlier, the biggest thing is they just haven't practiced that much. Like, they practiced on the 11th and the 13th. They played on the 14th, 15th. They took the 16th off. They practiced today on the 17th. So they've really only had two or three practices as a team, probably two as a full team. And that's what's going to get this system going, is just getting these guys on the ice and practicing with the coach. So I think as we get further into the month and they have more time to practice, we're going to see things just click into place a little bit more every game. It's just a matter of how long does it take until we get to 100% of where we need to be.
Well, hopefully it's sooner than later. Otherwise, like with the impending 14-game stretch starting on Saturday, like that's not going to be fun if they're coughing up points and hemorrhaging them one right after the other.
Yeah, it's. I don't want to say this week is going to be make or break, but I think that this week is really going to be a test of the Flames, see if they can stay consistent. They're playing a lot of hockey in 1 week and just kind of see, you know, hey, can we consistently play? Or sometimes last year we saw where if they played too much, they just got frustrated and started making dumb mistakes. And I think this will be a week where we'll find out just how much they can go in 1 week. Well, Matt, we will talk to you next week. Hopefully coming in, let's cross our fingers with 6 points. On the board, that would probably skyrocket us near the top three in the West, depending on how everyone else does. But we will wait and see, and we'll talk to you, hopefully not have too much blowback next week.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Have a good week, and we'll catch you next week for another episode.
Go Flames, go.
Go Flames, go.
This has been another Fireside Chat. Don't forget to subscribe to the show at firesidechat.ca. Follow us on Facebook at facebook.com/firesidechat. And to follow us on Twitter at Fireside Podcast. Catch our show on the podcast channel at thehockeywriters.com. Fireside Chat is licensed under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share-alike license. Hosted by Dan Stevenson and Matt Dubor. Produced and edited by Peter Marino and Ryan Coetz.